tail between their legs. So humans retain this capacity to lie. Now, in terms of other species and what they can do, what we transition to is a really interesting subfield of this whole subject, which is attempts to teach human languages to other species, attempts to teach language to other primates. And that has a long and storied past with all sorts of disastrous outcomes and huge controversies getting at this issue of what sort of cognitive aspects of language do we potentially share with another species. Okay, all of this has been with chimps up until the last 20 years or so. And it started off with a poor chimp named Vicky, who belonged to some researchers back in the 1930s, and I forget who and where. And what they decided was they were going to teach Vicky to speak English, naturally, and to speak. And how are they going to do it? Using the then cutting edge, just emerging principles of behaviorism, Vicky was subject to behaviorist rules. If she wanted water, she would have to make a sound that vaguely sort of sounded like the word cup. She'd have to make this sort of exhaling, barky sort of thing, which if your imagination really ran away with you, would sound like the word cup. There were a few other one-syllable words where they wouldn't feed her unless she made whatever sound they said was close to the word food. This was one screwed up chimp. In terms of seeing films of this chimp, this was one incredibly neurotic animal. And thank God, after only a few years, the researchers decided, you know, this isn't working, and this poor animal was allowed not to have to go through this anymore. Oh, this doesn't work. Soon after that, there was another chimp that had one of these sorts of upbringings, and this was raised by a psychologist named Kellogg at, I believe, Yale. And what this person was oriented to was Judith Rich Harris's work on peer influences, even though she wasn't born yet, the notion of peer influences. Why couldn't Vicky learn English? Because she didn't have a peer. You need to have a chimp grow up with a human, the two of them growing up together with the exact same environment and same treatment, and the human, who's really good at acquiring language, the chimp then will have a peer, will have a role model, all of that, and will pick up English as well. And thus, the Kelloggs raised their child, Donald. Donald was raised with this chimp, and I'm forgetting the chimp's name, but Donald fared almost as poorly as Vicky. And they did this whole study on the acquisition of stuff and sort of studies of the two, and these whole books written about Donald and his chimp brother there. And what was supposed to be happening was the chimp was going to learn English from Donald. And what you saw developmentally, the chimp, of course, was miles ahead of him. The chimp was climbing trees while Donald was still cruising on sort of the couch kind of thing. But in terms of language stuff, it never went that direction. What wound up happening was Donald started making the vocalizations of a chimp, at which point his parents stopped the experiment. But this was totally nutty. They were doing things like they did this experiment on like auditory acuity in the two of them. You could see this in the book. They filmed them. There's Donald, and I believe the chimp's name was Gua. And the two of them were sitting there being perfectly happy, sitting on a lawn, and they were being filmed, high-speed film. And what does the damn father do? He sneaks up behind them with a starter's pistol and shoots it so that they can get on film. But which one of them has the faster reaction time of being scared out of their wits by their father shooting this thing behind them and showing, oh, what do you know, Gua had slightly faster panic reaction stuff. So this was something that fortunately hit a wall. And Donald, I believe, wound up having a very interesting life, and I don't think it was urban legends. I wish I remembered, but it made perfect sense given what a bizarre childhood he had. Okay. Soon, people realized, or not so soon, then in the 1960s, some researchers finally realized what the problem was with this, which is it is absurd thinking that a chimp is going to learn how to speak a language because they simply do not have the larynx that can do it. They do not have the larynx that could produce discrete sounds like that. It's impossible, not because they're not smart enough, but they simply don't have the anatomy to do it. And thus, this was a couple, University of Nevada, named the Gardners, who came up with the brilliantly creative idea of teaching a chimp American Sign Language. to bypass the vocal limitations and just get at a system that chimps have great manual dexterity, tap at the cognitive aspects of language, bypass the sound vocal business, and thus came the first sign language ape, a chimp named Washo. Washo was the darling of sort of linguists, psycholinguists in a while, because there was something so cool about a chimpanzee sitting there being able to sign and sign language. Washo, by the time she was about a half dozen years old, had acquired about 150 different signs in English, and she could communicate with the gardeners with it, and people were producing like these glowing sorts of articles about them, where I remember this one guy, a science writer, who happened to have deaf parents, so he was raised bilingual with both English and American Sign Language, and this article about going to visit Washo and the bizarrety of speaking to a chimpanzee in his native language, and how cool is that? And Washo was being reported to do a hallmark feature of language use, which is to begin to invent words, where she combined the word water and the sign language for bird, put them together to water bird, and that's what she called ducks. Oh my God, she's made a new term. She babbled. Before going to sleep, she would do her favorite signs to herself and babble herself to sleep. She used sign language to lie and to do all sorts of stuff she shouldn't have been doing. And Washo lived in this trailer on the campus there, and they often had this video camera up sort of at night filming her, and they would have a low light there, and every now and then you would see things like there was a refrigerator there, and Washo was not supposed to open up the refrigerator and steal food out of it at night, and suddenly the camera's there and the trailer's absolutely quiet and empty, and suddenly you see Washo walking across signing, saying quiet Washo, quiet Washo, and raiding the refrigerator that way. Totally cool stuff. They brought in a second chimp to have Washo and the chimp start learning sign language and start talking to each other. And a couple of months into it, they had the first conversation in sign language ever by another species. The two chimps were sitting there and facing in opposite directions, and they both made use of what in every one of these projects was the first word that any chimp ever mastered, which was tickle. Because chimps love to be tickled. And the first sentence they ever master would always be, tickle me, tickle me. So there's the two of them sitting, Washo and Bowie, I believe his name was. They're sitting there, and Washo says, tickle me. And Bowie says, tickle me. And Washo says, tickle me, 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 me. And Bowie says, tickle me, tickle me, tickle me. And finally, the two of them get up and walk off in opposite directions. There you have failed detente in the very first conversation there. So my God, they're even talking to each other. This is totally cool. Meanwhile, a guy at the University of Pennsylvania named David Premack had his chimp named Sarah, and he was very irritated about the imprecision of sign language. He was teaching Sarah a whole sort of pattern, a whole language, a symbolic language pattern of different shape magnetic tiles, and showing very rigorously that Sarah could do if-then type clauses, could begin to do embedded clauses, saying things like he would put up the sign saying, if the red ball is in the bucket, go hoot crazily and joy. And, you know, Sarah would be able to do this and be able to construct these as well. Nothing very much resembling the fluidity of language, but nonetheless showing really sophisticated structure to it. So these guys were rolling along, and everybody loved this, and this was the greatest stuff ever. Chimps speaking American Sign Language, and you could sort of hang out with them and tickle them, and they'd never tickle you back, apparently, but showing, interviewing an animal in its own language, none of that reciprocity of tickling stuff with a human. But then along came the ape to end all apes when it came to sign language. Coco the gorilla. Coco the gorilla started off her linguistic life here on campus. Coco was originally a gorilla up in the San Francisco Zoo, and a graduate student, by now I can't remember how many decades ago, named Penny Patterson in the psychology department, decided that for a bunch of reasons, gorillas were going to be a lot more focused. Compared to gorillas, chimps all have ADD, and Coco was going to be the one, and she managed to get a loan of Coco from the San Francisco Zoo. And apparently during that era, like half the days you could be going around campus and there would be like Coco going by on a bicycle with Penny Patterson or some such thing. So Coco's this baby growing up here on campus, totally cool. Coco begins to learn American Sign Language. And what was clear was this was the ape of all time when it came to learning American Sign Language. Coco was amazing. Coco was learning stuff. Patterson was reporting the most astonishing thing. Coco could report dreams. Coco could gossip. Could gossip as in there would be two people on the project who like had a fight in front of her in the morning, and later in the day she could tell one of the other humans that the two of them were having some fight thing or whatever. Coco could gossip in American Sign Language. Coco could do anything. Coco could philosophize. Coco could lie like crazy, of course, because all of these chimps and apes immediately begin lying like crazy. Here's one of the things she was reported as doing. So Coco's left alone in this room, and there's a plant, a potted plant there, and nobody's around, and Coco being a gorilla, what does she do? She looks around, there's nobody there, so she eats the plant. So after a while, in comes Patterson, and says, "Oh, what happened in sign language to the plant? Where's the plant?" And Coco, who like has been caught red-handed here, Coco says, "Bill ate it." Bill, the poor bastard grad student on the project, oh, blame the grad student. So Patterson says, "Don't tell me that. Bill's not a gorilla. Humans don't eat plants. Gorillas only eat plants." And Coco sits there and says, "Some other gorilla." Some other gorilla. So this was amazing. Coco was just the best. So suddenly, Coco was like double dating with Madonna and endorsing dance skins and aerobic exercises and the Coco diet and things of that sort. And it was totally great. And this was the best gorilla ever. And this was the best ape. And they brought in this male who was supposed to like knock up Coco so that she could have a baby and teach her baby sign language and multi-generational gorilla teaching philosophy to their children. And all of this was great. And then around 1980, all of it got ruined. And it got ruined by a guy at Columbia named Herb Terrace. Terrace had been another one of the ones starting one of the sign language chimp projects. And he started with a chimp who was going to disprove Noam Chomsky. Noam Chomsky, who argued that there was no way anything that these chimps or gorillas could do would actually count as language, he was going to prove him wrong with his chimp, who he named Nim Chimpsky, to disprove Noam Chomsky. So there was Nim Chimpsky, and Nim Chimpsky starts learning. Nim Chimpsky starts learning American Sign Language like all the other ones, and Nim Chimpsky, as opposed to like Washoe, who's living out there in the American West and Manifest Destiny and all of that, Nim Chimpsky lived in a townhouse up on the west side in Manhattan, and you know, was a regular favorite at Lincoln Center and Zabar's and all of that. And the person who got the bagel probably knows what I'm referring to, but nobody else does. And Nim was just growing up there and learning sign language, and Nim was great, and Nim was terrific and learning just as fast as the other ones. And actually, the summer after my freshman year, I spent the summer working with Nim, which was incredible fun and tickling him and him not tickling me back, and it was all so exciting and getting to do this all day long with a chimp and moving on, and then Terrace and crew beginning to expand on this. And then suddenly, about 3 years later, out comes this big landmark paper in science by Terrace and some of the colleagues there, basically saying, you know what? Nim is totally cool and he is a blast to spend a long weekend in with and that sort of thing, but he's not learning language. This really doesn't count. And you know what? None of the other ones are either. And what you had was the first real hard-assed analysis of what these animals were producing. And what Terrace demonstrated in this paper in great detail was nothing Nim was doing fit the criteria for language. Nim was not inventing words. Nim was not getting word ordering correct. Word ordering was basically at the random level, me eat and eat me, 50% chance of either when expressing the same notion. Nim was failing to do something that was very fundamental to language, which was the more words in your string, the more meaning to it. And what I have on the handout at the very top was like some famous quote from Nim, who was just babbling on and something incoherent, suggesting like a Broca's aphasia, except that he was fine. As the utterances got longer, they didn't contain more information. Moreover, the utterances were not spontaneous. Language is not about answering questions. Language is about choosing to communicate. Nim was not generating any of this. He was responding to, if you answer this, you will get a Fruit Loop, which is what he mainly ate. And thus, most of the people on the project were constantly stealing his Fruit Loops from him. So this looked pretty bad. And what Terrace then proceeded to do was the same analysis on all the other projects, and none of the chimps were doing anything. All of them were failing these same criteria of accurate word ordering, expanded meaning with longer utterances, spontaneous, all of that. Washoe, oh, coming up, the duck is a water bird. Washoe was saying, water, bird. Well, no, it had not just neologistically come up, if that's the word, with a new word for duck in American Sign Language. It wasn't doing that. The word ordering made no sense. It was completely random. Terrace rips apart the whole literature. So out of that emerges the great bloodied prize fight of 1983 between Terrace and Penny Patterson. Penny Patterson, who had by that point had stolen cocoa from the San Francisco Zoo, and you think I'm kidding, she had been promised cocoa for only a certain number of years, and then of course she was going to give him back, and when it was time for her to give him back, she said, I'm not giving him back because he has human values now and it would be unfair for him to live with a gorilla. So that was just on the edge of being a lawsuit built around whether or not Coco could be emancipated along the lines of having human values, because she had been, you know, like skating on Lake Lagunita when it was frozen or things like that. And the San Francisco Zoo, seeing a public relations disaster on the horizon, decided, what the hell, let's give this $60,000 gorilla to Penny Patterson, who by that point had pretty much had her association with Stanford cut, and then by then was up in the Woodside Hills at a large estate paid for by gorilla enthusiasts and hanging out there with Coco. So Patterson winds up being the strongest defender down to the end that this is real language that Coco is doing. And Terrace going completely after it. And one problem at that point was there were no actual data that had ever been published by Patterson. All there were some several heartwarming films of Coco and global warming and Coco and the trade deficit and Coco and this or that. And there were no data. Scientists couldn't make any sense of it because there were no numbers. There was no anything you can actually analyze. And then you look at the films and they would be pitiful. They would be pitiful. Coco would be sitting there, for one thing, would never be generating spontaneous utterances. Coco would be sitting there having the same word order randomness as all the chimps. Coco would be having, and part of the problem was Patterson kept enabling Coco. She would ask Coco, what do you call this thing? And Coco would come up with a completely wrong sign, and Patterson would say, oh, stop kidding around. And then Patterson would show her the next one, and Coco would get it completely wrong. And Patterson would say, oh, you funny gorilla. And then, and I'm really serious, and I mean it this time, and so when he gets it wrong again, and oh, Coco is being so ironic these days. What? What are you talking about? She's going on like that on these films here, and as you look closely, using the sort of criteria that Terrace was using, your socks knew more American Sign Language than this gorilla did, and showing none of the spontaneity, none of the word ordering, none of any of that stuff. So out came the knives, and here were the basic stances. Terrace's stance was Patterson wouldn't know a controlled experiment if it hit her over the head. Patterson's response was Terrace was this cold, affectless fish who had driven Nim into virtual autism. And this guy Terrace was not someone who you would want to sort of cozy up and sit on your, sit on his lap and have him tell you bedtime stories or whatever. And another feature that Patterson pointed out very, very accurately was Nim had no continuity of teachers. Nim had all sorts of people who knew 3.5 more words of sign language than he did, like me, for example, who would show up for a summer and then disappear. He was going through 20, 30 different teachers a year. Oh, that's not a very good setting for learning stuff. That's not ideal. Language is not just about language, it's about the emotional relationships. And Nim ultimately wound up being a pretty screwed up chimp in terms of like nobody stable in his life except for this cold fish Terrace who basically didn't like him. So it's going back and forth and these accusations and Patterson coming out with just incredible stuff and Terrace going after her, and then things got really dirty, really dirty. Patterson beginning to suggest that, well, maybe Nim wasn't playing with a full deck compared to the other. Oh, so Terrace got the stupidest chimp in the entire sort of literature there and did the best analysis on his inadequacies and is trying to take down the whole field. Totally messy, messy sort of conflict there, and pretty much the whole field collapsed in the aftermath of it. Patterson is still up in the hills of Woodside, although I hear rumors she's about to move to Hawaii with Coco, to a large estate that she's gotten somebody to give her. She sends out things like newsletters talking about Coco sends greetings for world peace and things of that sort. I met her once and she wanted to talk about this gorilla Michael was brought in, and Michael, who was supposed to mate with her, but they brought him in when he was too young and they did a kibbutz brother and sister deal instead and just did folk songs together, and Michael wasn't working, he wasn't mating with her, so they eventually brought in this big larger male, and Michael promptly died of heart disease, which I thought probably had a major stress component, and that seemed perfectly legitimate, and was talking with that, and then was informed that October is going to be really tough because the end of October is Michael's birthday and Coco's going to have a really hard saying, is anybody else hearing this? Am I the only one hearing this? You think something's off here? They have continued there, and Terrace pretty much took down the rest of the field. In the aftermath and the remnants of it, there remains one chimp who I think legitimately qualifies as using something beginning to resemble true language. And this is a bonobo chimp named Kanzi. And Kanzi, they are doing everything right. It is clear that Kanzi is incredibly smart. They are doing all sorts of data analysis, and Kanzi is learning stuff. Kanzi is doing embedded clauses. Kanzi does if-then stuff, logical progressions. Kanzi is able to do a whole bunch of things. Kanzi can do analogy. Small ball is to small bucket as big ball is to, and she will indicate big bucket. She can do analogies like that. And most intriguingly, not only is Kanzi generating language and spontaneous and all of that, is that when Kanzi makes mistakes identifying things, they tend to be within semantic categories. She accidentally comes up with the sign for apple when she means to say orange. She doesn't accidentally come up with the sign for existentialism when she means to say orange. It's semantic categories, exactly the sort of stuff you need. So at this stage, most of that field went down in flames. At one point, people were making a deal out of the fact that there's like not a whole lot of gorillas left on Earth. And when supposedly Coco and Michael were able to like be talking their hearts out with each other, when you calculated those two gorillas and the total number of gorillas on Earth and how many people speak American Sign Language and how many people on Earth there are, a greater percentage of Earth's gorillas were speaking American Sign Language than Earth's humans. Like, that was stuff coming out of their time. So the entire field has collapsed. Kanzi remains about the only hope for making sense of anything going on with this. Really appealing, seductive stuff, not a whole lot of science. Okay, so what we will pick up on Wednesday is the genetics, evolution of language, and then trend.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.